first question is related to that. What was the driving force for you? Like, how did it all start going into academia and doing the research? Very
I fell into it. I was doing my MA at Leeds University, and my practical element was lighting design, and my theoretical element was circus. And I emerged from that, and everybody else in my program was applying for jobs, and I thought that that seemed like a reasonable thing to do. So I just started applying for the same sort of jobs everybody else applied for. And within a year I got one in a theatre department, and I found myself doing this job that I had never even known existed before that. Growing up I didn't actually realise that there were such things as theatre academics, otherwise I might have signed up for that. And what I discovered, because this was in the early 90s, is the politics of research in UK institutions, which was gradually becoming more professionalised and also moving practitioners into research. And so I quickly tried to find a vocabulary to process my practice and my critical concerns through research. And I also very quickly found out that to get ahead, you needed a PhD. So I actually kind of fell into research because I was working at a university. As opposed to working in a university because I was a researcher. I became a researcher through working at a university at a very particular historical moment in the UK where we got to shape the kind of discourse of practice research, which is exciting. Although my PhD isn't in practice research, because when I started my PhD, it was 2 years before anybody could actually do a PhD in the UK through practice. Although I did end up supervising, I think, one of the first 10 in performance in the UK, eventually, a few years after that.
Thank you very much. Now we're very happy to hear.
Bitches of Brew!
If somebody else can do it, huh?
I love significant dates. So on 1/11/99, I turned 33, and I was born in 66. When I became a professor, I did my first performance lecture on my 45th birthday. That was chosen deliberately, and the date was 11/1/11. And next year, I'm going to do another performance for my 50th birthday, and that one's going to be on 16/1/16. Clearly, as you can probably figure out, that isn't my actual birthday, but I think it actually is more pleasurable in terms of sequence and structure and shape. And exactly 45 years ago, in 1970, Miles Davis's album, Bitches Brew, was released. And this is the starting point for my presentation today. And, you know, I know what you're thinking. You're thinking, she could have pretty much chosen anything, couldn't she? You know, because 65 years ago, Ionesco's play La Cantatrice Chauve was first performed, or 40 years ago, the film version of the Rocky Horror Picture Show came out, or 20 years ago, Pulp's album, Different Class, came out. So, you know, you get the idea. It seems kind of arbitrary, except it isn't. I'll come clean. Last month, I was asked to be a keynote provocateur and respondent at a conference in Leeds that took place at the Tetley Centre. And the Tetley is a regenerated art space in the former headquarters of a former brewery. And the brewery shut in 1998 because it was bought out by the Carlsberg Group. Anyway, as a respondent, I was asked to actually think about the theme of the performance, which was brewing performance, and its purpose was really to explore the possibilities for the metaphor of brewing, to think through the writing, the experiencing, the participating, the talking about performance. So, you know, to brew is to transform, it's to let something settle, it's to create the conditions for ingredients to affect each other. Brewing is relational. Brewing is affective. We might think about brewing as the site where the organic is controlled, but also where it is free to grow and infuse. Not unlike the NSU, I think. A cup of tea, trouble, storms, mischief, they all brew. But this afternoon, I want to take this a step further and suggest that we might not only use brewing as an allegory for performance, but also my chosen example, that is Miles Davis's Bitches Brew, methodologically as an allegory to think through some issues arising from the making and consideration of contemporary performance today. Now, the sociologist John Law wrote a paper called Making a Mess with Method. And in this, he suggested that we start thinking about the potentials of allegory as a research method. So Law writes in this paper, and I quote, here's a quick and dirty set of suggestions. Allegory is the art of meaning something other than or in addition to what is being said. It is the art of decoding meaning, reading between literal lines to understand something else or more. It is the craft of making several not necessarily very consistent things at once. It is the art of crafting multiplicities, indefiniteness, undecidabilities, of holding them together, of relaxing the border controls that secure singularity. So for Law, using allegory performatively to structure non-coherence strikes at the very heart of the politics of research today, a politics which insists on definition and singularity rather than unruly assemblages, which is how most of us experience it as researchers. So what I'm about to do is to try to make a mess using Bitches Brew as an allegorical touchstone, politically, culturally, and also aesthetically. I have absolutely no answers, I have a few opinions, and a few provocations to make. And what I want to do is reflect on and respond to some of the conversations I've had the privilege to hear at the NSU this week, many of them within the artistic research circle, and some of which are on the post-it notes above. Alliteration. B. Bitches Brew. So I don't really want to pretend for a minute that I'm an expert on Miles Davis, or jazz, or even music. You can find almost anything I have to say about any of those things on the internet pretty easily. So I actually do apologize to those of you who actually do know about any of those things. But to fill you in, Bitches Brew is the album which really popularized what's known as jazz fusion. It's one of the very first. And it moves jazz really from the intimate clubs to the giant stadia where the rock dinosaurs roam. It moved, in Miles Davis's case, record sales in the tens to the hundreds of thousands, at least for a little while. Bitches Brew still appears on sort of the top 100 albums in both jazz and the rock charts. It's seen as an absolutely seminal and important album. There was a 2001 Jazz Times article, which I will actually, I've used quite a bit, and I'm going to be quoting on, using to quote as well. And it starts with, regardless of how the quality of the music on Bitches Brew is judged, it is important to recognize the astonishing concoction of influences that had gone into Miles Davis's cauldron. So, what they actually describe in this Jazz Times article is the confluence of what they say are polarities. So anything that was appearing in the late 1960s from one side or another was coming together in Bitches Brew. Jazz, rock, classical, African, American, improvised, notated music, live playing, a lot of post-production. I'm going to be talking about a lot of those things. And most people feel that its greatness or its quality is in how it bridged these particular polarities and sort of transcended the individual ingredients to explore something that they call an intangible musical universe, which I think really echoes a lot of the things that Ben was saying in his first keynote about structures of feeling, and I want to return to that as well as we go through. Bitches Brew was also an example of bringing together a collective of people to collaborate. One of the musicians describes it as a giant pot, and that Davis was there like a kind of sorcerer, an alchemist, saying, I'll take a pinch of this drummer, I will take a teaspoon of this electric piano player, I'll mix them up together, and I will have something unique and interesting. So although it comes from his vision, it actually arises from collective creation. Okay, so I want to listen to some of Bitches Brew together. For neatness sake, this is actually going to come from the eponymous track, which is called Bitches Brew. If you have a pen or a device of some sort and you feel like it, it would be great if you jotted down some of your thoughts that you could articulate while listening to it. If you don't, it doesn't matter, hold them in your head.
Thank you.
actually quite difficult to just listen to something in a room together, but I also feel it's a quite special experience as well, not being distracted by the visual all the time or listening to the spoken word. So I want to just go through, before we move on, a couple of different ways that you might sort of think about the way you just listened to that music. And I'm going to categorize it in five different ways. The first one, did you think about how the music made you feel, what its affect was? The second one, did it make you think about something else, its associations, metaphoric, mnemonic, or symbolic? Did you find yourself thinking about its sound properties, trying to describe those? Four, did you think about the techniques and skills that produce and enable those sound qualities? Five, did you think about the aesthetic and cultural context and structures which those properties, techniques, and skills sit? They're all very different ways of listening and things that I am going to touch upon through the rest of this talk. Perhaps you didn't write anything down at all. Perhaps the effect on you was indescribable, it was ineffable. That's fine too. All responses are fine. Perhaps you moved between them and you were able to actually mark the shifts in register as you were doing so, from the cognitive to the emotional and back again. So to be clear, I'm not arguing that this music will or should speak to you today as it felt to someone 45 years ago, nor that it is somehow universal, or that its quality is self-evident or non-contestable. You might love it. It might somehow transcend time. It might not. All of that is absolutely fine with me. In his first keynote here at the NSU, Ben Highmore stated that we live culture in a solution. And this seems to be particularly apt when thinking through Bitches Brew, both as culture and a product of its culture. One of the drummers who played on the album called it African-American classical music, a combination of the harmonic language developed in the West over several hundreds of years, played from an African-American perspective, with an African-American approach to rhythm. So what's left when we separate out those discrete parts is unique, unmanageable, effervescent. So Bitches Brew was absolutely groundbreaking, and one of the reasons for this, besides its fusion of hegemonic, dominant, and post-colonial cultures, was its absorption of countercultural tropes. And it began with that stark title and also a memorable cover painting, which you probably just looked at for 5 minutes. Davis actually invited the artist to make that painting, very expressionistic, with the zeitgeist of free love and flower power, with a naked black couple looking expectantly over the ocean with a huge, vibrant red flower beside them. And this actually expressed what Davis was trying to achieve with this particular album. He had been married to his wife for a year. Her name was Betty Mowbray. She was a particularly sort of righteous, sassy, fabulous woman who was half his age. And she introduced him to bell bottoms and P-Funk and Parliament and Sly and the Family Stone, and actually introduced him to all of these sort of countercultural elements which hadn't existed in his work up to this point. He was in his early to mid 40s at this time. So performance and performance makers ferment through cultural material and material culture. But perhaps more generatively are those performers and performances that ferment through opposition and oppression. Bitches Brew reminds us in its transformation of hippiedom into a form of Afrofuturism that these are not the same things, oppression and opposition, although they may be yoked together for ideological reasons. And it just gets me thinking, what is counterculture today? What does it look like? What does counterculture sound like? Is it possible that in this connected digital age, where every single radical gesture is subsumed by the spectacle, that this is absolutely impossible? Same as it ever was, of course, but it happens so much more quickly now. The word neoliberal has come up in numerous contexts and sessions over the past few days. You couldn't help but notice it. And I was particularly struck by Davide's statement during a Circle 7 session, and he said, I've become a neoliberal machine to operate in a system where I can resist neoliberalism. And I was thinking about that, and I was trying to actually think about different ways that contemporary performance makers actually work that through. So I started as close to home, or this home, as possible. I've recently been introduced to the Lithuanian opera, which is called Have a Good Day. I don't know if any of you know it. I think in Lithuanian it's Geros Dienos.
Yes.
Yes? And what happens is you have 10 women sitting on the stage and they're playing cashiers. And as they sit there and sing the sort of minimalist score, they sing about their lives, they sing about their goals, their disappointments, but they're at the same time robotically chanting shopping lists and sales incentives. When it was performed in the US last year, the New York Times described it as charming and quietly subversive, a critique of capitalist entrapment and consumerist obsession. So there are gentle ways that people are actually working to subvert neoliberal assumptions from within the neoliberal situation of professional theater making. And another example, one that keeps coming up very frequently here, is walking practice, particularly aesthetic walking practice. And perhaps the countering, that this is a sort of countercultural gesture, and why this is becoming such a globally ubiquitous phenomenon. It advocates slowness, it advocates sensuality, it values personal reflection, close attention to detail, enchantment, reverie, situationness. Sometimes the community moves alone, sometimes together. There's a network community of walkers who communicate together all the time, even if they walk alone. And also, walking seems remarkably resilient and remarkably able to make remarkable political statements of resistance, both in practice and also a symbol. So a very, very recent articulation of its culturally specific significance is Maya Krishnareo's solo performance, which was called Walk, and was performed just last month in India, in Hyderabad. And this is about the woman's right to be able to walk the streets of India's cities, day or night, without being afraid for their safety. She composed as a protest over the gang rape of Jyoti Singh Pandey on a bus in Delhi, which I'm sure everybody knows about, December 2012. And the piece has been performed in multiple spaces, from streets to schools and colleges in India. So the harnessing of walking as a sort of counter-dominant, counter-hegemonic gesture is something that seems to be a global phenomenon. Duration. Discipline, documentation, digital. I'll go for discipline. Particularly with regard to Miles Davis's Bitches Brew, I think that there are three different types of discipline that come out that are relevant to this particular conversation. The first is a branch or a system of study or knowledge. The second is a system of rules or conduct or methods of practice. And the third is a developed behavior. So the listening and writing exercise, if you chose to write, that you did earlier, actually would root out your disciplinary perspective very easily. If you were a musician or came from a musical background, you would be disciplinarily able to actually identify the way those sounds were made, what they possibly meant. If you were a musical historian, equally, you would have actually been able to set that within a cultural genealogy and so on. In performance, though, we are almost always working sort of interdisciplinarily or intradisciplinarily. Technically, there are probably four or five disciplines within the overarching umbrella of performance: drama, theater, dance, and music, all of which are different but have various similarities. And ironically, the term performance actually stands for kind of aesthetic performances like live art, but also circus, while at the same time acting as a meta-discipline for all of them. I'm a professor of performance studies, and that is a very particular thing. It is actually called or referred to as either an anti-discipline or a post-discipline, in the way it absorbs absolutely everything in the sluggiest way possible. And, just as Ben Highmore noted when discussing Raymond Williams' interest in culture as both anthropological and aesthetic, so performance studies, at least as it developed in North America, crosses sort of theater studies and anthropology, especially as it was expressed by Victor Turner. And what that means is, in performance studies, you are taking two different approaches at any given moment. You're looking at things that are performance, things that the is of performance, aesthetic performances like theater and dance and circus and stand-up comedy, but you also look at the world as performance, so that you would look at walking as a performance. You would look at eating as a performance. You look at dressing as a performance. And so within performance studies, what we're usually doing is looking at the various reiterations and how they're actually absorbed, going from cultural and social performance to aesthetic performance. Now, the theorist John McKenzie wrote a really influential book about 10 years ago. It's called The Former Else. And what he actually said is that we actually live in an age of performance, and that the word performance is used as something measurable. It is actually a capitalist statement. We can talk about the performances of stocks and bonds, for instance, your performance at work, key performance indicators, and things like that. But in performance studies departments, ironically, he says, we take for granted what is known as the liminal norm. In other words, whereas in the rest of the world, performance is almost right-leaning, looking towards that which is measurable and quantifiable. Whereas when we're talking about performance as performance and is performance in performance studies department, we're always looking for the in-between. The efficacy is actually seen in the liminality, in the ability to sort of to get rid of those binary oppositions, like the polarities that I was talking about when describing Miles Davis's Bitches Brew. This or that, this and that. And instead, what performance studies tries to look for is that sort of the structure of feeling that is insoluble, that is left there. And the idea is that in this liminal norm, social norms can be suspended, challenged, played with, and perhaps even transformed. So, ironically, this anti-discipline or post-discipline tries to subvert disciplinarity, and through the subversion of disciplinarity is trying to create transformation. Nicholas Rideout wrote a book about 5 years ago called Theatre and Ethics. It's a slim volume and very, very interesting. And he structures his book around a question posed by a character in a play by Sophocles. That is, how shall I act? And he says that this is both a theatrical question and an ethical question. So the book actually charts how theatre reflects the changing nature of ethical frameworks and focuses. It's structured in three different sections. It moves from ancient, modern to postmodern, a move from the focus on the self to people who are the same as us, to people who are other than us. And Rideout argues that the ethical dimensions of theatrical productions and spectatorship cannot be separated from the specific historical circumstances in which they take place. But what happens when ethical values shift, or when, in the words of the Big Lebowski, new shit comes to light? Returning to my earlier question about counterculture, he notes that recently ethics has seemed to displace politics as the ground through which we talk about responsibility. However, ethical experience becomes the condition of possibility for a particular kind of relationship. The ethical relationship becomes, in its turn, the ground upon which political action may be attempted within the performance sphere. So why am I saying this? Miles Davis may have been a genius, but he was an angry man, and he was a violent man. He beat women, including all of his wives. And as a strange coincidence, a tidbit, Davis actually married his third wife, Cicely Tyson, at Bill Cosby's house. I think that what this does is raises some really immensely important questions for us today. To what extent are we able to separate the art and artist from his everyday actions, from his aesthetic processes, from his products? What does it mean when we excuse or we exempt those we consider to be of great cultural significance? Should we, can we forgive or excuse, if not forget? How does this color our perception and positioning, performance cultures, lineages, and genealogies? And like many women, I was thinking about this week, as I was reading a story about Jackie Flukes, who used to be Jackie Fox in The Runaways, who claimed that their manager, and The Runaways were a very young girl band, their manager, Kim Fowley, actually raped her in a hotel room full of people during an after-show party where The Runaways played. And for many people, this actually forces us to rethink a lot of our preconceptions and also the joy that we take in listening to this music of free exuberance, the sexual charge of sort of being a young person again, the celebration, the enactment of sexual openness as freedom and as empowerment. I think in its way, Bitches Brew and thinking through Miles Davis as a wife beater opens up all of those questions as well. Let me carry on with that one. There are no women on Bitches Brew except on the cover. And all considered, things really haven't changed that much in 45 years. I'll give you some statistics, and this is from the UK, okay? Now, as The Guardian's Lynn Gardner notes, in certain performance forms, in particular live art, performance art, and also community and children's theater, there are a lot of women practitioners. They're very highly valued. But things are very different in mainstream performance genres environments. According to statistics released last September, of the artistic directors working across 179 theater organizations in the English Art Council's national portfolio, 63% are male. In organizations receiving more than £500,000, only 24% of artistic directors are women. While women make up the majority of drama students and even theater goers, it was found that among writers of new plays produced in leading theaters, all of the leading theaters in the UK, only 24% were female. Similarly, in 2012, in the UK's 10 most subsidized theater, only 24% of directors were female. And in music, it is even worse. Last month, The Guardian actually published statistics about how many of the performers on all of the main festivals and the main music festivals in the UK were women. They found that 86% on average of the performers at music festivals are men. If you look at some of the big rock festivals like Reading and Leeds and Download, 94 to 96% of the performers on the stage are still men. I'd like to think that things might be different in Nordic and Baltic countries. Perhaps if you don't know, you would like to find out. I paid you 5 minutes of the song Bitches Brew. That was actually a fifth of the total track. The track itself comes in at 26 minutes. And what's really interesting about it is that the musicians themselves didn't actually experience this. The final version was actually cut together from a variety of live tapes. So as a result, some of the musicians actually heard it elsewhere and didn't realize that they were playing on this album that sounds incredibly live. What happened is that having rehearsed it and constructed it in the studio, they then went out as a much smaller unit and did play it live. So one of the things that Davis was playing with was duration. And in terms of performance in general, you could say that this was very much of its time. So in 1972, for instance, Robert Wilson staged Calm Out in a Gardenia Terrace at the Shiraz Festival in Iran, and that was over the course of seven days or 168 hours. So duration was kind of in the air at that particular time. But I think actually we've returned to a durational moment for some of all the reasons I actually mentioned in relation to walking earlier, the slowness, the taking time, the finding of attention. I watch a lot of durational performance. Actually, I get bored under about an hour, but about 5 hours, things really kick in for me. and I sort of go into a kind of trance, a kind of inner experience that I enjoy an awful lot. But it can't just be anything. I found, having watched a lot of durational performance, that there are certain things that artists have to do, and one of them isn't just doing something because you do it for a long time. I think this is actually one of the mistakes that a lot of young artists are making, or that programs are making. Just because someone boils lots of eggs for 12 hours and eats them doesn't make it particularly interesting. So I'm getting kind of sick, this is the provocation bit, I'm getting kind of sick of duration for duration's sake, but at the same time, I'm also really worried about this tendency, at least in the UK, to fit performances in 90-minute boxes so that they fit into fringe festivals with no intervals because they're afraid people are going to leave. So that it seems that performance forms are actually being shaped not out of necessity or the work itself, but actually through either kind of faddishness or sort of capitalist imperatives. So where is this taking me? It's taking me to Brew. I was just like genre durational performance, taking me to the concept of Brew. Because what we actually want to advocate is the idea of an animating force at the center of a performance in any genre as groove. So groove is that device in music that tends to be rhythmic, that actually drives. And you, I think you started to get a sense towards that particular clip of Bitches Brew, of how the groove sort of generally takes over. One way that I have read it being described is as a kind of line aligned with the natural gravity of the universe and its resulting motion and momentum, like a tire track. So it's as if you're sort of being forced along a kind of a path through rhythm, with each of the recurring parts in that groove playing its own instrument, fulfilling its own role, repeating and rotating around. So Bitches Brew, the reason I thought about this is that Bitches Brew is dominated by circular grooves. And as at least one person said, without the groove, actually what that would just be cacophony. So what I'm sort of advocating for is for especially durational performances to think about not the way things are structured so much, but actually the groove that we can create within performances of any length. Hands. As benefits an icon, Miles Davis was photographed a lot. He was usually glowering very moodily at the camera, looking outrageously fly. But perhaps more evocative is a series of photographs taken by Irving Penn of his hands in 1986, and this is one of them. My colleague at Plymouth, John Matthews, published a book last year called Anatomy of Performance Training. And in his chapter on hands, he suggested that training, and so I'm going back to discipline here, is a process of learning how to predict the future. So once your body learns and becomes familiar with a task, you no longer have to think about precisely what you're doing. Prehension involves not only acting automatically, but also predictably. And what John argues is that as we train in anything, not just performance forms, but anything, we are better able to predict future outcomes in our respective disciplines. And while all this leads to virtuosity, it paradoxically limits our capabilities in some directions while extending them in others, since you are less able to adapt to something new that comes up if you are used to always doing the same old thing. As Miles Davis said, you have to play a long time to be able to play like yourself. I actually read that on a quote on a Tumblr site, accompanied by that particular photograph. And I think Bitches Brew shows us how a virtuosic old dog might learn new tricks. And let me make this really clear. I am also advocating what we might consider a return to virtuosity in all forms of performance practices. It is something that we've actually moved away from in the postmodern and post-dramatic era. But I think what's actually happening now is we realize the extent of the skill and technique that is actually required to produce performance, and that the collaboration and the unskilledness that we see in companies, for instance, like Forced Entertainment, is being taken up in a more political sense with socially engaged and relational practices. Improvisation. So Bitches Brew was essentially improvised in a free avant-garde sense. The musicians don't play within certain forms, they don't play within certain chord changes. Basically, they had to listen to each other. Miles Davis gave them very, very few instructions. Sometimes, in fact, you can kind of hear him clicking his fingers or suggesting various things as he goes along, because he wanted them to basically, he gave them just enough to allow them to go. But what he was relying on was the intersubjectivity and the communication within performers in the room. Now, Davis was also combining these improvisational methods with musical influences such as rock, folk, and soul. But mainly, he was working with sort of the call and response of African-American traditions. And he did have to rehearse with them a little bit in the nights before, which is really interesting because people assume that improvisation doesn't require preparation, but actually it requires not just a lot of training and discipline, but probably some advanced sketching as well. Now, by a strange coincidence, this week, the comedian Stuart Lee, who's a British comedian, hosted a BBC Radio 4 program on free improvisation. And one of the women practitioners who he interviewed actually pointed out that because of engagement and exchange between the musicians, between the technicians and the art, and the bodies of performers and their audiences, that free improvisation can actually be seen as a moral and a political act in quite the same way as that sort of, as a countercultural sort of discourse. It requires the generosity of time, of the audiences, it enables music to grow, and that she says that improvisation enables people to grow physically and emotionally. She says, quote, "You enter a different kind of time, and you enter into a different relationship. So in a sense, you're functioning in a society that is running in parallel to conventional society." I think that's a really sort of interesting take on improvisation. J is for Jonathan Meads. You might not have heard of him. He's an architecture critic and broadcaster from the States who lives in France. And I secretly wish I was really a lot more like him. He makes these television programs which are like really erudite, uncompromising, visually complex, sardonic, and witty. And I'm also currently reading his autobiography, which is called The Encyclopedia Myself. And one of the things he actually does is he structures both his television programs and also his own autobiography through alphabetical captions. Now, he has this neat little trick of using a subject heading to sneakily lead into what he really wanted to say, like if the alphabet doesn't quite work for him. So the thing about Jonathan Meads that I really want to say is that he refuses to dumb down in a cultural climate that I would describe as increasingly anti-intellectual, at least in America, at least in Canada, and at least in the US, which is what I know the best. He makes work that is difficult, it is challenging, he does not spoon-feed his audience, just like Miles Davis's Bitches Brew. So, here's another provocation. Let's not be afraid to make and find pleasure in performance that's a bitch to understand. K is for Keynote, that's what I'm doing. but Keynote is actually obviously a musical term, and that was what Miles Davis was doing when he was trying to set the tone, the mood, and the way forward for his musicians in a space. It's something to enable collective creation, to enable, in a conference setting, conversation. So my goal with sort of throwing out all of these things is to engender discussion. But actually what I am really trying to do is try to capture the tone of what I've been hearing rather more than throwing things out. Even allegorical messages have their own rules, so I suspect we won't have a lot of time to talk immediately after this, but hopefully over the next 2 days. Processes, protocols, rules, allegorical messes have all of those, just like brewing. Knowledge. I really don't want to infer that I'm somehow more knowledgeable than anybody else. The knowledge that we're actually producing here is a collective knowledge, a communal knowledge. But it actually does lead me to something that I think is incredibly relevant both to artistic research, to performance research, and also to what Miles Davis was doing, which is understanding some things as a form of embodied knowledge. I recently read an essay on dance in a journal on theoretical medicine, and I think it's a really great quote. They write that, it's Block and Kissel, write that embodied knowing is the ability to interact with a thought or an experience holistically that involves the integrated power network of the total person. The integrated power includes neural elements, memory, language, perception, and attunement that are found and integrated through the body, not just in the brain. It is the way we process the experience of life. And quite a few people have written about embodied knowledges. One is actually, from a practitioner research point of view, that we actually enter into a triadic relationship as practice researchers of creating and performing and appreciating all at the same time that creates a kind of feedback loop. Liveness. This has actually appeared quite a bit on the backboard, mainly in relation to documentation. And liveness is sort of at the heart of a lot of performance discourse, as anybody involved in the anti-discipline or the discipline will know. And it all comes, it really originates from a statement over 20 years ago by Peggy Phelan in her book Unmarked, where she writes that what makes something a performance is that it resists representation, and as soon as it's actually documented, it becomes something other than performance. And she wrote, to the degree that performance attempts to enter into the economy of reproduction, it betrays and lessens the promise of its own ontology. And that's precisely where that sort of transformative potential of the liminal norm comes from, that we are working in this brave new world against representation, where what we do cannot be commodified. Now, what I think is really interesting about Bitches Brew is that it seems remarkably prescient in relation to these dominant discourses of performance, ontology, and epistemology. So, although three tracks were broken in by Davis's live quintet prior to the recording sessions, the rest were created through the making of the album. They were recorded over several sessions using shifting personnel, always valuing spontaneity and the sweet spot of perfect collaborative moment. And then it was constructed and edited together later. So Bitches Brew is at once a documentation and an original performance. And most, though not all, of the tracks were then played, as I said, live on stage as a touring group. So the idea that there is some sort of lineage between a live performance and a documentation went out the window sort of 45 years ago. I'm not exactly sure why we're still holding on to it. In this age, this digital age, we can be much more creative. Midlife crisis. By the time he made Bitches Brew, Davis had an extraordinary career. He was at the front of bebop, he played with Charlie Parker, he took Dizzy Gillespie's spot in Charlie Parker's band. He was at the forefront of cool jazz, hard bop, modal jazz. He could have coasted, but he didn't. And it was actually his drummer, Jack DeJohnette, said that the process of Bitches Brew, while thrilling, was actually just a playing through of Davis's midlife crisis through experimental jazz, and that's actually what you're hearing. And that makes me think a lot about aging and performance. Obviously, I discussed this to some extent in my first presentation, especially with regard to Joan Rivers. And maybe there's some sort of weird connection to make between Davis embracing sort of elements of youth culture in his 40s and Joan Rivers hosting Fashion Police, I don't know. But back when Bitches Brew was made, we really did not see elder rock musicians because it was a new genre. And of course The Who hoped they died before they got old. But of course they didn't. And so while we're seeing a lot of older performers now, and by this I mean sort of older performers who are not actors but creating their own material and evolving the content with their bodies, we're starting to see an entire new sort of chapter in the aging body on stage. So I'm interested, for instance, in Peaches, the electricity's musician and performance artist. So she's incredibly aggressive and flamboyant and genderqueer, and she's playing out her aging. She's now in her mid-40s in front of our eyes. The lyrics of her album, I Feel Cream, exhort lovers to lick my crow's feet. And she sings, never mind my age, well, she sort of sings, it's like we're breaking out of a cage. And I think there's something in that, in Bitches Brew as well, the breaking out of the cage, sort of the conventions that that Davis had already created, but also his own aging process. Okay, negotiation. So here I started to think about intercultural performance. And there are a lot of different models of intercultural performance. There is, for instance, Erica Fischer-Lichter's intercultural model, which involves grading. The really famous one going back is Patrice Pavie's hourglass model. And I start to wonder whether all of these sort of filtering and modelings and things, why we can't just be talking about mashing and bubbling instead of sort of grading, that actually get to the point where things actually really do affect relationally each other, as opposed to being able to pick out these discrete bits. As we do, sort of in Patrice Pavis's hourglass model, where we move from a source to a target culture. And I think this is really, this is the same sort of undercurrent that runs through the concept of interdisciplinary research as well. There's this sort of source discipline that affects a target discipline, and really what we have to be talking about is much of more of an electric charge and a mashing and an effervescent throughout. So I'm not really thrilled with the idea of a source and target culture, but it actually leads me to think about one of the questions that arose in the artistic research group, which is, what is a neoliberal audience? Might reaching them be some kind of utopian vision for performance makers? So the sort of the source culture of a radical performance maker trying to reach the target of this so-called neoliberal audience. And I had a really interesting conversation with Karen Bentley Pollock, who performed for us on the first night, but sadly she's had to leave. And we were reflecting on Monique Wernhan's really remarkable performance within the artistic research group. It was a performance lecture during which she used sort of humor and pathos and really sort of steely-eyed pragmatism and a lot of creativity. Monique's presentation was about how she could sustain herself as an artist. And we were talking about this, and what Karen said to me, and she actually did say that I could share this, so I'm not just talking out of turn unethically. She said that she actually had an epiphany watching Monique's performance, which is what performance is all about. She said that in the Sustainable Women presentation, Monique was providing goods and experiences to a group of her economic peers who are seeking community, mutual support, exchange of love and ideas. So that sort of transformational potential of performance. But the upper classes are not actively seeking the same experiences of soup and song. They prefer isolation and elite experiences. Thus, there is and will remain a disconnect between the flow of grassroots art creation and sharing with a population able to sustain it. And I think that there are many such paradoxes in everything I've tried to bring up. I'm trying to express sort of very paradoxical situations in this paper, or sort of paper thing. So we have discipline that promotes its own sort of coming apart and transformation, hard structures that promote freedom. And another one of those paradoxes is the temporal one. So getting back to that sort of debate about liveness and documentation, Adrian Heathfield wrote an essay called Then Again, and he wrote, "Performance is a temporal paradox. It exists now and then, it leaves and lasts. Its tendencies towards disappearance and dematerialization are countered by its capacities to adhere, mark, and trace itself otherwise." What we learn from the brewing process is that creation needs to be cultivated. Now, Davis actually described his own sessions as follows. "I would direct like a conductor once we started to play, and I would either write down some music for someone or tell them to play different things I was hearing as the music was growing and coming together. While the music was developing, I would hear something that I thought could be extended or cut back. So that recording was a development of the creative process and a living composition." And I really like the idea of sort of different varieties of media of performances coming together through a collectivity of people as an organic and living extended practice. Davis is repeatedly referred to as an alchemist, as a sorcerer. There's a certain magic in the effect he produces. And I think this is what we might refer to as auratic presence. So we understand the concept of auratic presence as like charisma or inexplicable attraction. Performance phenomenologist Berto States talks about presence as self-expressive, and he links it particularly to virtuosity in a performance. performer. And Davis often actually played with his back to an audience. He was so charismatic. Sometimes he would just like stand on stage whispering in people's ears, and then a few minutes, like, you know, just play nothing, and then people would applaud wildly because they were so thrilled with the charisma of his particular presence. He would like piss off and people would still be applauding after him. This phenomenal body of the performer affects audience members through presence, which is generated through technique and practices of embodiment. Again, Erica Fisher-Lick says that this is actually linked to presentness as well as charisma. And that, this sort of performer is present in an unusually intense way that in turn creates an intense sensation of themselves as present. Questions. So for me, the performances that are of the greatest value are those that don't simply provoke questions, but actually have questions at their core. How do I do this? How do I express this? What happens if I do that? I'm not particularly interested in performances that are going to give me the answers or think that they know the answers to begin with. The Jazz Times article that I quoted earlier asked this question. They say, what is most often asked about Bitches Brew is whether Miles Davis had a vision for the end result or was just randomly throwing things into his cauldron and was then surprised as anyone else at the end. And one of the musicians on the album said, did Miles have a vision? I'd say yes. But did he know what the end result would sound like? I would say no. He couldn't. When he was putting something together, he was listening, he was selecting what he liked. But this is the great art of improvised music. I'm also particularly interested in the sorts of questions that we might ask as performance makers and artists in general. I was at a presentation by Lois Weaver, who was one of the members of Split Bridges and is a performance artist who's American and based in the UK. And during this presentation, she asked two questions that I'd also like to offer you, and I think that they are sort of relevant to the big meta questions that Davis was asking himself at this time. And she asked, what art could we make to help affect change? And secondly, what art would we make if our lives depended on it? In almost any interview he gave, Miles Davis spoke about the differences between white and being black in America. It made no difference that he came from a relatively affluent middle-class family. He told a Playboy magazine interview that one of his first memories was being chased down the road by an older man who was yelling, "Nigger, nigger," after him. And in his autobiography, Davis stated, some people have written that doing Bitches Brew was the head of Columbia's idea, or Tio Macero's idea. I'll get to Tio Macero in a moment, but he's the producer. That's a lie, because they didn't have nothing to do with none of it. Again, it's white people trying to give some credit to other white people where it wasn't deserved, because the record became a breakthrough concept, very innovative. They were going to rewrite history after the fact, like they always do. And in a 1973 interview, Davis complained, as long as I've been playing, they never say I done anything. They always say that some white guy did it. And that's the reason why the covers of his albums, including Bitches Brew, all say at the top, directions in music by Miles Davis, followed by his name. He wanted people to know that he had conceived this as well as playing on it, that this was his product. Now, I hardly have to say how important the issue of race and politics and blackness are in this particular historical moment, politically and artistically. But more specifically, we watched a beautiful film last night by Agnieszka Piotrowska. It was an incredibly reflective film called Lovers in Time, which just demonstrated the great degree of sensitivity that we still have to take in representing and negotiating the presentation of blackness when you are not black yourself, and the sensitivity involved in still working across white and black cultures. And I felt that this movie actually summarized many of the concerns, because she was working through them so carefully and explicitly, that Davis was actually just expressing in that quote. Another example that really is ringing true at the moment is the case of Brett Bailey's exhibit B. I don't know if you know about it, but Exhibit B was an exhibition, a live performance exhibition that was modeled on the concept of the human zoo. And Brett Bailey is a white South African performance maker who made this as a rigorous critique of racism and colonialism in the Belgian Congo in particular. I saw it in Avignon, I felt it was a bit didactic, but very hard-hitting. It was making its case incredibly clearly. But in the UK, it caused an incredible amount of controversy, in particular by the black community who protested so that the Barbican Theatre in London actually pulled it from the programming. And what this conversation is about here is about who has the right to represent black bodies and how is it done. And I think that this is something that Miles Davis was dealing with. He worked with white musicians and black musicians. He had white lovers and black lovers, but he was always acutely aware of his status as a black artist in not just in America, but further afield. So Benheimer describes structures as fixed and solid, and I certainly don't disagree. There are a number type of structural constructions in Bitches Brew, both of which I think speak to us as artists and audiences today. The first form of structure was the construction of a structure within the live space, the ritual space, in which an intersubjective collaboration and collective call and response can take place. It's an oral tradition. It's one that is about bodies coming together. The second structure, however, is the larger scale structure that happened in the studio afterwards. And here is where Tio Macero came in, in the studio as the producer. And he was steeped in 19th century classical music and musical structure. And he was actually looking at Bitches Brew in terms of abstract chunks of sound, which he freely cut and moved around. So he was drawing on cut and paste, musette concrete, serial music and studio technology, which is, I think, a lot of what we're seeing massively influenced ambient and dance music to come. And I think we're still working through how do we structure for both live encounter and also technological involvement as well. So carrying on with technology, editing is actually at the absolute heart of this album. As I say, perfection for Miles Davis was capturing the essence of something, being in the moment, and then editing those moments together to put them together to capture the feeling of being in the moment, the intensity of the music. And I think now more and more we are all editing our experiences that way on YouTube and to our friends and family on social media. It was, despite what Davis said about getting credit, it was clear that the collaboration was between he and Tio Macero was incredibly important because they placed the two long tracks, which are full of like 12, 13 edits at the very beginning, at the very start of Bitches Brew, the first things that you actually hear. They're a kind of declaration of intent. So it creates a sort of subliminal sense of unrest through this sort of structure, something that's initially hard to grasp, but eventually what it actually does is lifts the idea of the music out of just the jam session into something more constructive and solid. Utopian performatives. Jill Dolan came up with this term. Utopian performance is the idea that something visceral and emotional and social, that connection actually happens in moments of performance that we can't quite articulate. It's what a better world feels like in an ideal situation. It is one of intersubjectivity, one of encounter with the other. It is a feeling of utopia that is found within specific environments, of being human together, of feeling love and hope and commonality. And I think this particularly aligns with the idea of improvisation as well. Back from Stuart Lee's program, One of the musicians says that what's great about improvisation, what she loves about it, is that it is based on trust, that whatever is going on in your life will come out as a form of transmutation. It's filtered through sound and interaction and skills, but it is completely raw. And she says that what she loves about improvisation, that it is, quote, everything that's ever been unfolding in a new moment. And I think that is the ultimate in utopian thought. But also the unknowingness, this focus on becoming, on in-betweenness, on process, the idea that the final outcome of a performance, and I would say whether this is improvised or otherwise, must be ultimately unknown if it is going to be meaningful. Because why should we go through the process if we know what the end result is going to be? I've talked about virtuosity and Davis's vision. Voodoo. So the practice of voodoo is a particularly potent form of intercultural spiritual performance and also an ethical system that's transmitted orally across generations. As most of you know, I'm sure, it originated with slaves who combined elements of both Roman Catholicism that was imposed on them by their masters onto West African Yoruba traditions and beliefs. But actually what I was thinking about when I put voodoo up there was Jimi Hendrix. Because one of the tracks on Bitches Brew is called Miles Runs the Voodoo Down, which actually is a tribute to Jimi Hendrix. Davis was introduced by Hendrix by his wife Betty. Later he jealously accused them of sleeping together, which absolutely incensed her. In 1970 they appeared together on the Isle of Wight stage before an audience of 600,000. Davis was wearing like red leather jacket and blue rhinestone trousers and getting into the whole deal. In a session, in an interview with Rolling Stone a few months after Bitches Brew, Davis reflected on white rock music, which he found embarrassing. He said, quote, "But Jimi Hendrix can take two white guys and make them play their asses off. You've got to have a mixed group. One has one thing and the other has another. For me, a group has to be mixed. To get the swing, you have to have some black guys in there." Words. Okay, so a few weeks back, Slate magazine, the online journal, published a video taxonomy of the word bitch in Orange is the New Black. I don't know if you get that here. You don't have to watch Orange is the New Black to appreciate the video clip, which illustrates the variety of innovative ways that characters reappropriate the term bitch. In addition to referencing sexual subordination, like prison bitch, which is always already feminized, and then reenacting a sort of rather straightforward power dynamic, Slate argues that the gender-flipping use of the word bitch in the program enables performances of flair, verb, and rhetorical skill. So it's more about the user than the addressee, and works at what they say is defanging what might otherwise be considered anti-woman. And similarly, the feminist media organization Bitch Media claim on their website that their use of the term is empowering. And this is from the website. "People call me a feminist whenever I express sentiments that differentiate me from a doormat. We'd argue that the word bitch is usually deployed for the same purpose. When it's being used as an insult, bitch is an epithet hurled at women who speak their minds, who have opinions and don't shy away from expressing them, who don't sit by and smile uncomfortably if they're bothered or offended. If being an outspoken woman means being a bitch, we'll take that as a compliment. We know that not everyone's down with the term. Believe us, we've heard all about it. But we stand firm in our belief that if we choose to reappropriate the word, it loses its power to hurt us. And if we can get people thinking about why they're saying what they're saying when they use the word, that's even better. Bitch, they say, is a noun and a verb." And I would add, like brew or groove, they both echo the slipperiness and power of performance itself. One of the nicest definitions of performance that I've come across is by Ellen Diamond in her book Performance and Cultural Politics, and she says, "In our simplest references and in the blink of an eye, performance is always a doing and a thing done. There is no apostrophe at the end of the word bitches in Bitches Brew. That makes brew a verb and not a noun. Who brews? Bitches brew." Some critics have assumed that bitches referred to the musicians themselves, and just like the word motherfucker, the term bitch can be used as an accolade in African American vernacular. I'm actually working on a paper on motherfucker as a feminist statement. I won't bother you with that here. So this brings us to the concept of the performative as a speech act, which is where the concept of the performative actually begins, of naming, of calling out. The cultural environment in which agency is brewed, but also in which the body is disciplined. Performativity and the resulting performative produced through it is always a process and not a product. It's hard to come up with X's. There is no xylophone on Bitches Brew, but let's talk about excess. And getting back to the idea of sort of the relationship between the live and the documented, the live and the mediated, there's a great book that came out 10 years ago by Diana Taylor called The Archive and the Repertoire. It's about cultural performing cultural memory in Latin America. And what we have on one side, and she won't actually describe this as a binary, but so often people do, is we have the archive, which is documents, maps, bones, literary texts, things that are material objects. And then there's the repertoire, things that are passed on through bodily knowledge and exchange. It could be songs, it could be dances, it could be oral traditions. And what she says is that the archive and the repertoire are not binaries, they're things that always work in tandem together, with one always exceeding the other. And that is actually how meaning is made. But also, Bitches Brew included 13 musicians. It's an absolutely massive cast of characters to try to harness within a studio environment. On the third day, the rhythm section consisted of 11 players, 3 keyboardists, another electric guitar, 2 basses, and 4 drummers. So I think in terms of provocation, what I'd say is, in a time of austerity, more is better. Don't let anybody tell you that you have to keep stripping things down. I just read a performance that's happening in my hometown next week by Serena Porta, who's a visual artist, participatory performer, performance where she's trying to get 21 drummers with their drum sets in the center of the city. More is better in the time of austerity. Okay. Why? I had trouble with why, right? So, yeast. So yeast is at the center of the brewing process. As far as I understand it, fermentation takes place through the metabolic processes of yeast. I recently saw a digital artwork by an artist called Stephen Fortune in which the biological processes of yeast fermentation were linked to the development of software. But what really interested me is that the artist described the live and digital materials he worked with as inspirational technologies. It's a phrase that really caught my attention, especially in its potential relationship to Foucault's technologies of the self, which of course, when combined with technologies of power, lead to our state of governability in Foucauldian terms. And in one of the Circle 7 sessions, we discussed inspiration in as a non-commercial value, something countercultural that we can aspire to. And Ilya reminded us that it is a word one derives from the act of breathing, inhalation. So back to yeast and another allegory. The process of respiration that is involved with yeast fermentation is divided into 2 distinct phrases, inspiration or inhalation and expiration or exhalation. Zed. Joe Zonal played the electric piano on Bitches Brew. Bitches Brew was not just a cultural product, but a cultural environment which created new organisms in itself. In the early 70s, Zonal and Wayne Shorter, the saxophonist, were involved with Weather Report. Herbie Hancock and Benny Mopan, these are all people who played on Bitches Brew, set up Milwan Dishi. John McLaughlin created the Mahavishnu Orchestra. Chick Corea founded Return to Forever. So all of the young musicians that Miles Davis was working with went on to become absolute leading lights and stars in the jazz scene throughout the 80s. And just as the groups that grew out of Davis's Bitches Brew sessions, I have here Theatre Czar, because I thought I would mention something that particularly struck me last year, a performance which I found absolutely extraordinary. Theatre Czar were brewed within the culture of the Grotowski Institute, so came out of the work of Jerzy Grotowski in Poland. And I saw their piece Anelli in a very hot church, almost as hot as this room, at the Avignon Festival last year. And it's the very final piece of their Gospels of Childhood triptych. It was really lo-fi. The company's work revolves around vocal precision and very hot theatrical language. It is not improvised, but it is developed through a very extended collective ensemble process. And despite those differences, like Bitches Brew, Anelli merged musical styles and traditions. It merged Byzantine and Sardinian paschal hymns. It merged Orthodox music traditions. And it was also very excessively cast. There was way too many people on stage, especially what we expect in our so-called sort of rich Western Euro-American theater context. We never see that many people on stage anymore. Its theme was unity and disintegration, corporeality and possession, all of the things I've been talking about today through Miles Davis. It's about making a vessel for the other, for a future life, and out of our own selves. And to finish, there is actually, going back to the very beginning, because it's a circular groove, another anniversary that we can commemorate today. Yesterday would have been the 90th birthday of Franz Fanon. And so I'd like to leave you with a quote from the man who wrote Black Skin and White Masks, a trope that Miles Davis did everything he could throughout his life to destabilize. This quote comes from The Wretched of the Earth, which was published in 1961. Quote, "Let us reconsider the question of cerebral reality and of the cerebral mass of all humanity, whose connections must be increased, whose channels must be diversified, and whose messages must be rehumanized." Thank you. Genres that we can talk about. You probably have a better idea than me.
And my last question by Eduardo.
Oh, I thought I was like the first.
Yes.
Well, thank you for that. Last summer in Reykjavik, we had a keynote experiment, which would be, we agreed with our keynote at the time that there would be an exchange of space and potential possibility, where the keynote was taken over by the group. We called it out of keynote, because you might use that if you want to.
Off keynote.
It's great to see a year after that the excellence of that exercise achieved so easily. And I would just like to point it out that this example of fermentation happened right here in this conceptual performance of all the reappropriation that or reiteration that you took the time to create of all the crossing that happened during your stay. So I think that all the active listening and conceptual feedback exercise that we just experienced, that was quite inspiring. So yeah, thank you for that.
That's very generous, thank you.